We'll be right back. Hence, as we always do in the recitation of Holy Quran, I request Dr. Muhammad Akram Shahzad to kindly recite the Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألف لام
according to government's own statistics, in 1994, More than 2,000 people have been killed and many more injured. And in 1995 alone, up till now, about 525 persons have been killed and many more injured. A recent survey conducted reveals that 99% of the people of Karachi are affected somehow or the other by the lawlessness prevalent in the city. The role of the police has been equally appalling. According to a report published in Newsline in the November 1994 issue, police has been identified as the number one public enemy. The main gates of the police stations are closed by sunset. This is according to the report. Special guards with machine guns are posted at the police stations to open fire without second thought if there is a suspect at the gate. There is screening of visitors through a peeping hole. Senior police officers such as house officers, SIs and ASIs do not go for night patrolling. The police appointment of inspectors are on political grounds and they give themselves a waiver on police training. The situation of Karachi is very aptly summed up by another report, and I would take the permission to briefly read extracts from that report. The situation in Karachi, the country's most populous and most cosmopolitan city, was never so bad as it has been for some time now. The law and order has completely broken down, and even an organization like the CPLC has to advise the people to make their own security arrangements for themselves, their families, and the areas they live in. Our beautiful metropolis of Karachi has been turned into a slaughterhouse, where during the recent holy month of Ramzan alone, over 160 plus persons were officially reported to be killed. The actual number of those killed may be much higher, while no one single killer has been apprehended to date. Contrast the total lack of concern exhibited by the rulers to those killed in the city during the past several years with the springing into action of the whole state machinery on the killing of two Americans confirms that the blood of Americans was redder than the blood of people of Karachi. And this has been the report. Now, in the end, I would pinpoint at least five solutions which could be termed as getting towards a long-term solution of the problems. Number one, Karachi should be allocated a proper budget for the socio-economic uplift. Number two, the appointments in law enforcement agencies should be on merit and not on political grounds. And they should be after proper training. And number three solution is essentially the solution which has been proposed by a High Court judge of Sindh, none other than Justice Shafi Mohammadi, when he says that government and police officers should pay qisas and compensation to the victims. Number four, the entire anti-corruption department should be handed over to the CPLC. And number five, there should be more citizen police liaison. And that is all that I have to say. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I would request the chairman of our Pakistan Academy of Jurists, a profound scholar and academic, a jurist, an author, and of course, man of the moment, Mr. Abrahamson. Please welcome him.
Thank you, Mr. Farooq Naseem. In fact, I do not deserve these adjectives. In any case, at first I will apologize for starting this symposium late by 30 minutes. In fact, I have already enumerated in writing, and it is coming to you, the problem, the causes and the solution according to me of those causes of lawlessness in the city. In a nutshell, I will not read the paper. The paper will reach to you and you can go through it. In a nutshell, I would just point out that it has been in the press also, and it is the from government sources, that from June 1992 up till now, about 7,500 people have been killed in Karachi. An equal number of citizens have been incapacitated. Now those who have been killed belong to every ethnic section. They belong to every religion. And those who are suspected to have done this also belong to different ethnic sections and different ethnic, different religions or sects. So therefore, in fact, if we go still further from Ashura days, when the incident of Bushra Zaidi took place, and if we calculate the killings, then it will safely touch a figure of killing and incapacitation, then it will safely touch a figure of about 100,000 people. Now this is the magnitude. Today we are circulating another paper also. This is in fact a reproduction, or it has been taken from Pakistan and Gulf Economics. This article has been written by a conscientious, educated, innocent, non-political citizen of Karachi, and I hope this will be found of interest, because in what predicament we find ourselves has been very aptly described in this article. How an innocent, conscientious, non-political citizen finds it difficult to live in this city. Now, as far as my the paper is concerned, I must say at this outset that the main cause of all this is hatred. If we do away with this hatred against each other, then of course everything can be solved, but perhaps that will take several years to inculcate that spirit. The remedies which I have provided is active participation of citizens in the prevention of crimes, number one, and active participation of citizens in the award of punishment. Now, as far as the active participation of citizens in the prevention of crime is concerned, I have pointed out that if we suitably amend Sindh local government ordinance and add a chapter whereby we elect 10 persons from a unit who should ultimately supervise or assist the local police, it will be better. And then in the administration of justice, how people can be allowed to participate, I have suggested that for all cognizable offences, we must have a jury trial. And if we have the jury trial, and if the jury is left with the decision of pronouncing whether the accused is guilty or not guilty, and then the judge takes over as far as the awarding of actual punishment is concerned, that will allow participation of the people in the administration of justice or in the administration or award of punishment. In fact, I have categorized the measures which should be adopted by the government into two categories. Number one is short-term measures which have to be taken immediately, and number two is the long-term measures which have to be adopted in due course of time. So my paper ends on this note that in fact the Your Academy has already established a committee to give these recommendations, whatever recommendations come from you today, to give it a color of proper amendment in the relevant law. Police Act is to be amended, police rules are to be amended, and the Sindh Local Government Ordinance is to be amended, and the Criminal Procedure Code is to be suitably amended. There is no necessity of any amendment in the Constitution. It will be simple amendment by the legislature. So I have ended my paper with this, that volumes can be written about the subject, but due to paucity of time, I will stop here and leave the subject to your discussion and recommendations. On our part, we have already formed a committee of lawyers who immediately after the symposium will finalize their recommendations and will also propose the draft amendment in the relevant law to be made by the government. Thank you very much.
Career in the Pakistan Air Force. We had the privilege of representing Pakistan in three combats. A warrior who has fought for martyrdom but returned as a Ghazi in Captura. The next Vice President of Karachi Bar Association. Ladies and gentlemen, kindly welcome Mr. Umar Farooq Khan, presently Principal of SM Law College in the Faculty of Law.
My Lord Justice Mohammad Ali Sayyid, Chairman of the Symposium, Distinguished Abrar Hussain, Distinguished Ladies and Gentlemen, I am highly thankful to Mr. Abrar Hussain for giving me this chance and to address this noble gathering on the situation, law and order situation in Karachi. The Karachi is a gateway of Pakistan. It's the biggest industrial city of Pakistan. It's the only port of Pakistan and the biggest airport and international city of Pakistan. Now Karachi contributes more than 60% of revenue, and in Karachi the people living in Karachi, they come not only from all parts of Pakistan, but from most of the neighboring countries, Afghanistan, Iran, and even people from India, people from Bangladesh, most of the illegal immigrants, and presently, although there is no census, but the population of Karachi is more than 11 million people. It's more than a crore. The population of Karachi is more than 1 crore. Now, the law and order situation of Karachi started deteriorating after 1990, especially after the incidents mentioned by distinguished brother Abrar Hussain, a single accident case of Bushra Delhi ignited this trouble, and so far number of innocent peoples have been killed. Now, so far the much has been said on the causes of law and deplorable situation in Karachi, and much has been said that what should be the remedies. Now, I am practicing in Karachi since 1972. Now, there are respectable persons, they are very senior advocates, like judges, Nizam Ahmed is here, Mr. Justice Nizam Ahmed is here. In those days, there used to be one district of Karachi and one additional district magistrate, he used to sit in Karachi. Now, presently, we are having 5 deputy commissioners in Karachi. We are having one commissioner and 3 additional commissioners in Karachi. And there are 5 additional district magistrates and there are 5 additional deputy commissioners in Karachi. Now similarly, there used to be one district and session judge for Karachi, but for the same, now we have got 5 session judges and there are about 40 additional district and session judges. The number of other the administrative executive and lower judiciary staff has also increased with the same ratio. Now in Karachi there used to be about 40 police stations. Nowadays there are more than 100 police stations in Karachi. But if we look toward the job they are performing and the problems of the people they are solving, I'll come to the administrative side. Presently, since more than 5 years, none of the district magistrate, additional district magistrate, sub-regional district magistrates, and most of the magistrates, they do not sit in the courts and they are always busy with the large order situations. Whereas, up to 1980, the additional district magistrate, he was available to the ordinary public and he was also available to the litigant citizens. This is one of the causes that the administrative officers or the administration officers, they are not available to the public. They are not aware that how many cases are within and how what type of cases come before them. So far, the situation or the position of the police station is concerned. The most of the police stations, they are optional. And the higher is the bid for most lucrative police stations. And if we look into the performance of the police stations, if anyone visits the police station after 7 p.m. or after sunset, most of the police stations, they are locked, and when somebody goes to the police station, they ask him that who is that person, and some people are sometimes enter the police station, and sometimes they are not even permitted to enter the police station. People are scared, they are afraid to go to the police station. Presently, the strength of the rangers and the strength of the police. There are more than 45,000 police in the city and similar number of rangers, they are working in the city. The question is not the strength of the police or not the strength of the rangers. But the main problem is that the police personnel should be honest and the police personnel should know the problems of the people. The police should be from the places, from the same justice, so that they should know that what are the problems of the people. And so far the position is concerned, the main problem is that there is no rule of law in this country, there is no equality before the law, and there is no due process of the law. I am just quoting 2 sections of Criminal Procedure Code. If they are acted in spirit and in accordance with the law, then I am sure that the crime can be minimized to a great extent. There are only 2 sections. In the Criminal Procedure Code, there are only the preventive section. Section 109, it says that if
person who has got no ostensible means of living, he can be booked for 1 year line. Now, previously we used to see that from 10 to 15 years ago, that police used to challenge some of the persons, even the dead were not right. But now we see that there are persons, they have got no ostensible means of living, but still they are having big pajaros, and there is no action taken against it. So, this is only a preventive measure. Similarly, there is a measure under Section 110 of Criminal Procedure Code for the last more than 10 years. I am sure that not a single person is asked to furnish surety for being a person of ordered criminal person. So, there is no rule of law in the city, and so far the police is concerned. I say that they are not protecting the citizen, but they are protecting themselves. We find that the SHOs in charge of the police stations, they are guided by the police officer. And most of the police employees, 45,000, and it's not from the present regime. It started months ago. They are protecting their own officers, whereas pre-partition days, I'll see that there used to be one SSP and he used to have a petrol activity, not on a car, not on a pajaroji, but on a half pay. And wherever even a theft used to occur, they used to visit the police station. But very surprisingly, that people are killed in numbers. 10 to 15 persons are killed, and the highest police officers, they do not visit the place of occurrence. Now, so far the accountability is concerned, the if any person is challenged for anti-corruption or by the anti-corruption, he is sometimes a patwali, or the head of the sweepers, but no high official has ever been challenged for being a corrupt person, whereas under the corruption law, the definition of corrupt person is that a person who lives beyond his means or a person who is having reputation to be corrupt. But there are persons, there are police officials, their salary is 1,000 rupees and they are living in big palatial bungalows, their value is more than 1 crore and 2 crore rupees. Not a single police officer has been challenged so far about the rank of fair size for the last 10 to 15 years. So there is no rule of law and there is no accountability of it. In a year, there are in 1994, more than 2,000 people were killed, but not a single person was given death sentence by more than 50 session judges, 50 session judges and additional session judges who are working in the court. This is the situation of our prosecuting agencies or our prosecution agencies. Now I think I would suggest one thing, that at least the prosecution agency should be modified, and the prosecutors who are working in this court as a prosecutor, they should be attached to one court also. And they should be held responsible only to the extent of those cases which are challenged in the court so that the accused persons do not go unpunished. I'm thankful to you. Time is short. I should speak more about this. So thank you.
Just had news from our chief guest, Mr. Justice Fakhruddin J. Ibrahim. He's suffering from flu and he will not be able to attend, so we apologize. Ladies and gentlemen, the next speaker is a human rights lawyer, and singularly he has extensively contributed to the public interest litigation in this country. Ladies and gentlemen, I request Mr. Zia.
Mr. President, Mr. Amarasan, the Chief of Pakistan Academy of Jurists, and the officer, ladies and gentlemen. I think the forum which Jurist Academy has provided to us is also one step forward for the democratic struggle, because in democracy you need debate on different topics. So nowadays, what is happening in Karachi, we all know. We all suffering, we all have problems. Every bell at the door, we feel that might be some dacoit, some terrorist. Everybody is feeling fear. Even I can see that the intellectuals of this city, they are feeling fear and they are not coming forward. And it is a brave step that the Jurist Academy has arranged this kind of a meeting in which I can see a very, very prominent lawyers, journalists, very active and dedicated people who have served their whole life for the betterment of this country. But now they are just watching the situation that what is happening. They don't know. Everybody who is coming here, they are just criticizing police. But why we are not going to talk about the real issues? Because the real issue of this country is economy. You can see who is behind the whole drama. Everybody is talking that there are intelligence everywhere. Some say agencies. Nobody is talking about them. Whether they are accountable or not, you cannot even file a small petition in the High Court. Why the not only the police station doors are closed for the people, as like other friends have said, the police become a private force for any government, whoever comes in power, any political party, and they are using police as a private force. But what is happening with our tradition? Nobody is going to talk about how the appointment of judges is happening in this country from the beginning. Why, see, now people can't go to the High Courts and the Supreme Court and the lower courts? Because of thankless litigation. 90% people, they don't go to the court. They don't want to go to the court. There is a big gap between people and the tradition. As a jurist, I think we have to raise our voices against this. What I can see nowadays, that has become a culture of our legal community, that whoever is strong enough to talk about, or the associations like High Court Bar Association or Karachi Bar Association, they have been ruled. There are speculations always running in the court premises, in the bar room, that now you have become, you see, the person who is active. So the speculation is that he is going to become a High Court judge, just to stop him. I've seen a lot of people who were very dedicated before, but because they got this message that they might be appointed as a High Court judge. And now there are interviews. Every day, you see, I see people have been called by Chief Minister, Prime Minister, and other people to interview the senior lawyers for the potential of this High Court judges. I don't know what is happening with our tradition. Nobody is going to talk about it. The bar associations are not talking about it. If the doors of justice is closed for the people, then this kind of terrorism is happening everywhere in the world. I think we should go and see the poverty which is, you see, every day its level is going higher and higher. People are in real trouble. But what I can see, last week I was in New York to attend some conference, and Pakistani community, they were asking me what is happening in Karachi. Karachi jal raha. So they were saying, kya ho raha hai? Hum Pakistan jana chahte the, but now we have decided we don't want to go. So you can see that Pakistani who love their country and they wanted to come back from abroad, from America, from Canada, now they have stopped themselves because of the safety reasons. But there are so many things happening behind the whole situation. What I can assess from my own small knowledge, that in Pakistan, this law and order situation has been created by the agencies and the government. And the political parties are also involved in this, because they are also partner to it. Actually, what is happening in Pakistan and in Karachi, that there are very big issues like Kashmir, like nuclear issue, like the dictation of IMF to the World Bank to this country, and also the business given to the Americans. So what is happening? See, now the government want to settle in whatever way they want, and they want to, you see, keep busy the people in law and order situation. I think if I become head of the state or head of the province, it's not a very big problem to arrest some, you see, some people who are terrorists, because there are so many agencies, thousands of agencies. Every day they are shifting the problem or the allegation to police, or sometimes rangers, sometimes army. But there are, I think, behind the curtain, there are so many things happening. And I think we have to challenge what is happening behind the curtain. Who is eating the 70% of the budget, which the taxes which we are paying? Nobody is going to talk about. No political party or political leader is willing to talk about. They are silent. This is a criminal act, what I feel. And I think when we are here, so we should also talk about that what is happening with our judiciary. Why the judiciary is not vocal, which previously they were doing. They have started a chapter receiving the application of poor people who cannot afford or who don't have anywhere to go. Their applications were accepted in the high courts and in the Supreme Court. But now the whole door is closed. So I don't know. I can make a question to my seniors who are here, senior lawyers, ex-judges. They are here, and I think they will be coming on the roster to talk about the issue. So this is my question to them. What is happening? What happened recently to our judiciary? Where are we now? Where are the jurists who were talking about democracy? We were fighting against the martial law, and we were on the roads. We got sentences from the military court, and we were fighting for the rule of law. But now, why the people who were on the roads at that time fighting the cause of people of Pakistan, why they are silent? If they are silent, so it is a criminality. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Jayan Daman. Next, we welcome Dr. Muhammad Akram Shahzad.
ताकि ये अल्लाह के मकबूल बंदे किसी परेशानी का शिकार ना हो और इनको बता दिया गया कि अगर तुम्हें किसी वक्त कोई परेशानी आई तो उसका सबब यही होगा कि तुमने अपने रब और उसके रसूल के हुक्म की नाफरमानी की। अलामा इकबाल फरमाते हैं, वान करना फिरका बंदी के लिए अपनी जुबान, छुपके है बैठा हुआ हंगामा ए नक्शत बयान। मोहतरम सामाई, कराची के क्या हालात हैं, पाकिस्तान के क्या हालात हैं, ये आप लोग बहुत अच्छी तरह समझते हैं। इनके बारे में किसी तरह की गुफ्तगू मजीद करने की जरूरत नहीं, और अगर कोई हुई भी तो हमारे मेहमाना ने गिरामी तशरीफ रखते हैं, वो आपको इंतहाई मुअस्सर इकदाम बताएंगे। मसला ये है कि अमन कैसे हो। अलामा इकबाल कहते हैं, अफराद के हाथों में है अफवान की तकदीर, हर फर्द है मिल्लत के मुकद्दर का सितारा, जितने अफराद मौजूद हैं तमाम अपने हद तक ये कोशिश करें कि अपने अजीजों अकारिब या अपने मोहल्ले में या अपनी गलियों में दूसरे अफराद जो रहते हैं उनके साथ रवाबित रखें, इसलिए कि जो लोग भी अमन को तबाह करते हैं वो तमाम लोग रात को फायरिंग करते हैं और इन्हीं कहीं गलियों में गुम हो जाते हैं। पहली बात तो ये है कि अगर आपस में अफराद के रवाबित होंगे तो उनको छुपने की जगह नहीं मिलेगी, और अगर अपने आप के रवाबित नहीं होंगे, अपने पड़ोस की कोई खबर नहीं होगी, तो फिर ये सिलसिला दुनिया की कोई ताकत नहीं हो सकती। इसको रोकना है, अमन चाहिए, तो फिर क्या है कि आपस में रवाबित पैदा करें, अखलाक पैदा करें। हमारे यहाँ कराची के माहौल में खुसूसन हर फर्द अगर दूसरे से मिलता है जाकर, या कोई भी मिलने वाला आता है, खा वो रिश्तेदार हो या कोई दूसरा मिलने वाला, तो आने वाले की तो न जाने क्या गरज हो, लेकिन सामने वाला जिसके पास आ रहा है वो यही सोचता है कि शायद इसको कोई गरज होगी इसके लिए मेरे पास आया। ये इसलिए थिंकिंग मौजूद है कि अखलाक नहीं रहा, और कानून इस कायनात में जो बनाए गए हैं या बनाया गया या कानून की जरूरत हुई वो सिर्फ इसीलिए हुई ताकि इंसान की अखलाकी कदरों को हयात जावेद बख्शी जा सके। दोस्तों, मुख्तसर से वक्त में सिर्फ यही कहा जा सकता है कि अमन की बहाली के लिए आपस के रवाबित जो हैं उनको खुलूस पे रखिए, और इसी खुलूस के साथ इस शेर के पेश करता हूं, इसी के अपनी तकरीर को खत्म करूंगा। आओ इस धरती पे वो नक्श कदम छोड़ चले, आओ इस धरती पे वो नक्श कदम छोड़ चले जिसकी आती हुई नजरों को जरूरत हो।
Ladies and gentlemen, our next speaker is a prominent advocate of the country, and he is a member of Board of Governors of Karachi University. Kindly welcome Mr. Bahadur Ali Naqvi.
Starts from 1947, being a citizen of country, we should look into the facts who started ethnocentric politics in this country and who gives them all similarities, including guns. Classical culture was introduced and all discrimination was not started today. As the said judiciary, first time in the history of Pakistan, all countries' advocates were deprived. And first time in the history of Pakistan in Sindh, that is taken by this government from all provinces around the country, all districts were given their proper right. And first time in the history of Pakistan, women ladies were taken and as well as the minorities quota fixed. And as concerned, the doors of courts are open. And when the previous scheme, nobody can say that their rights were given properly, were there a lot of institutions were cracked and everybody was sleeping calmly. They were surrounded by the gates and walls and everybody was hostages and nobody can talk. Now everybody is talking. Law and situation, we have to see that it is our city and we have to see beyond all the differences, all the sects, all the we are our emotions and affections. We have come up and we should coordinate with law enforcement agencies and people who are elected and have got the mandate of the people of Sindh and Pakistan. If we think that the situation is erupted suddenly and Karachi is become hostages and city of terrorism and murder, that we should see the surrounding of our country, that in Afghanistan, in Iran, in as well as in the Russia, all these geopolitical situations are also concerned today. We should sit together without any hesitation. We should work together for peace. If there is some requires some amendment, assembly is there, and then this forum is provided opportunity, press is free, and all the news are public. And no news is hidden anywhere. Every news, everything is clean in all the press and media, corporate media, as well as international media on CNN. You can see. We should come up and sit together and we should find out the solution with the legislation as well as we should give the right who is the right man. We should not be blind that if I born in the house of landlord, then he should become the MNA, he should become the judge, he should become the master. No, we should take now. We are citizens. If I am qualified, I should be given a chance. If we, anybody without any difference of language, color, creed, I quote the last sermon of Holy Prophet of 10:3, that nobody should be given any preference that he belongs to a rich family, he belongs to a poor family. We should see what is fair, and there should be check and balance what you can think. And we hope that if we think positively, without, we should indulge our political motives, as well as our personal motives, or anything, then we won't be able to get any solution. We should be able to get solution of this peace and law and order situation. We should sit together and find out a solution, and all the members of legislators, senators, MLAs, MPAs are elected are here, everybody can see and go and talk, and all these houses are open for debate and for legislation. I hope that we should come up with a patriotic person, with a citizen of Pakistan, not to come in confined in a cage. I hope we will think as a Pakistani, inshallah, we will be able to restore the situation with confidence, and the city of Karachi will be the, inshallah, soon you will see again become light. Thank you.
The next speaker, once again.
Mr. Chairman, distinguished participants, actually I'm here in a state of festivity before this August gathering. I can only say that we are in a state of crisis. I cannot suggest any solutions off the cuff, but I must say that we need to realize that we are in a state of crisis. And with all respect to the fellow speakers who preceded me, I would think that the traditional solutions of improvements in the Criminal Procedure Court, of methods to improve police efficiency, etc., might not be enough to deal with the present situation. The state. We need to face the fact that the state apparatus is breaking down